Good day, everyone. Welcome to Prayer Watch, and thank you for joining us today. Let us now come to the Lord in prayer. Loving and most gracious Father in heaven, we do praise and worship you today, a day that is truly coming from you. This is a day that you have made, and we praise you, Lord, because you are so good and your love endures forever. We thank you for your word that is light and lamp for us in this dark world. Thank you, Father, for your love that has no limit, your love that is always with us wherever we may be, however we may be situated. Dearest Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit to be our wisdom and our guide as we reflect upon your word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long
occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" What is written in the law? He replied. How do you read it? He answered, Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, And who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, The one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, Go and do likewise.
We thank God for those wonderful words of life. What is love? It is a topic that has probably been most discussed across the world throughout all the ages. Is it an emotion? A commitment? Is it a natural instinct? A person? A necessary part of life? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, once said, Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. He was quoting the statement from the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy in chapter 6, verse 5. Now at the time that he said this, it was a teacher of the law who asked him and who was interested in actually the second part of what Jesus said. The part that said, love your neighbor as yourself. And so that is what we shall reflect on today. The greatest commandment according to Jesus is stated clearly in Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 3. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. These two commands are inseparable. If you love God truly, then you must also love your neighbor, or you must also love others. As John said, whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command, anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Now we note, however, that the love for others spoken of here in John is specifically for a brother and or a sister, which in this context refers to a fellow Christian, and not just any person, such as a neighbor. But when Jesus was asked about what the greatest commandment was, when he said, love your neighbor, he was referring to people in general, whether they be Christians or non-Christians, whether they be people who are close to you or strangers or in fact your enemies. The neighbor covers everything else who is not you. Now, but the point is, in all this teaching is that love for God is authenticated by one's love for others. In other words, your love for others is evidence that you love God. I will venture to say, you may love others without loving God, that is the one true God, but you cannot love God without loving others. Now, since our relationship with God is one that is growing, it is true that our capacity to love others is a work in progress. Which brings us to the next point, which is that God commands His people to love Him and their neighbor. People are born self-centered. A baby is so dependent on the parent and at the same time concerned totally on himself, on what he needs. He cries when he is hungry, when he is wet or in pain, and he doesn't stop doing so until he is satisfied. He has no idea at all what the world outside him is like, and so he does not care whether his mother is tired, busy, or sick. All he knows is that he needs something, he needs to be attended to, and now. As far as he is concerned, his needs must be met. In a fallen or sinful world such as ours, the sad thing is that that baby does not become less self-centered even after he becomes more aware of others. Have you wondered, for instance, how a seemingly innocent baby manages to grow up to become a ruthless tyrant? And that is why we need God to give a command, to give the order, to instruct firmly for us to love Him and our neighbor. Now, you see, we need God to keep on reminding us, to teach us, and to set that very important principle in place. It is not something that comes naturally to us. We need God to command, to give the order. Now, there is a popular adage that says, you can't teach the heart to love. Well, that may be true about romantic love, but when it comes to love for God and others, God commands it of His people. He teaches it. It is a lesson that His people must learn. For this is the only way to truly experience the abundant life, the complete life in Christ. So, if loving the neighbor is the second most important command of God, then we are on our way to loving God as well when we love our neighbor. For as Jesus said, if you love me, obey my commands. So, to love God, to love Jesus, is to obey the instruction, or His instruction, His law of the abundant life, one of the most important one of which is to love the neighbor. In Jesus' parable, He went straight to teaching that love is an action word. You see, the teacher of the law was concerned. He was curious about what Jesus meant about loving the neighbor. Who is my neighbor? And so Jesus said, in so many words in His parable, He said, well, love is not an abstract concept. It is an action word. In fact, true love is concrete. There is a giver and the receiver of that love. The Bible says, let us not love with words and speech, but with actions and in truth. God acted by giving us we the receivers of His love, a Savior in the person of Jesus Christ, so that we may receive salvation. In the parable, two religious people, the priest and the Levite, who serve in the temple of God, came across a wounded man who lay helpless along the path, along the street. Now, both of them did not bother to stop to see if this man was still alive or to find out how they might be of help. Perhaps they were in a hurry for an appointment. Perhaps the priest was on his way to perform some religious ritual that required him not to touch an unclean person or an unclean body. And you know that, and as you know, the corpse of a human body is unclean as far as ceremonial cleanliness is concerned. Perhaps both of them were averse to blood and they were afraid. There may have been other reasons why they did not lift a finger to help. Or perhaps they did not know how to love their neighbor. In contrast, a Samaritan showed compassion for the wounded man and went out of his way to have him treated until he recovered. The fact that it was a Samaritan who was presented by Jesus as a model of love was an insult to the Jews. This is because Samaritans were looked down upon by the Jews as half-breed descendants of Israelites. They were second-rate Israelites, suppose, in a way, because the Samaritans chose to worship from Mount Gerizim, as their ancestors had done, instead of from Jerusalem. But even the teacher of the law couldn't help but conclude after Jesus' narration of the parable that it was the Samaritan indeed who fulfilled the command to love one's neighbor. Love for others is in treating them as we would want them to treat us. The Hebrew word for love used in Deuteronomy chapter 6 also had the sense of being loyal, to be loyal. Now we are inherently loyal to ourselves, meaning to say we want to satisfy that which we desire. Our interest, our benefit comes first. That is the natural people that we are. We naturally love ourselves. Our interests take first priority. In a way, even the interest of our loved ones, which we say we prioritize out of love, in a sense, also prioritizes ourselves, really, because our loved ones are an extension of who we are. So that cannot really be measured as love for others or for neighbors. So we are still loyal to ourselves. But here Jesus is saying, love your neighbor. He is teaching us to learn how to also serve the interests and needs of other people. When we are in need, we would like others to help us. When we are wronged, we would like others to take up our cause and help us. Loving neighbor is learning to help others outside our circle of family and friends. What keeps us from doing this? What keeps us from doing this for others? Well, sometimes greed, maybe selfishness, maybe because we always find ourselves without the time, without the strength, without the skills, without the financial resources to be of help. Then, if that is the case, why not strive to carve out time for others? Plan your day so that you may have strength and also have enough waking hours, not only for your own interest, but with some to spare to help others. Learn a skill whereby you may help others. Budget your finances so that you may have some extra left to give for emergency needs of others. In other words, plan your life with your neighbor in mind. The fourth and final point of the message of the parable is that those who love God can learn to love others. Can learn to love others. It is not too late. It is not an impossible aspiration to be able to learn to really love our neighbor. Our Lord taught this way of life by preaching as well as by living out love. Loving others is a virtue that is developed when one loves God and wants to obey Him. You know, as the Apostle Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Loving others is a lifestyle that is molded in a person who follows the influence of the Holy Spirit in him. It is the Holy Spirit who stirs up that spirit of compassion, that spirit of concern for others. It is a command that a submitted follower of Jesus Christ takes seriously and would not want to disobey. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, along our journeys, God causes people to cross our paths. Needy people. Their needs may be one time, short or long term, but they are our opportunities to show our love for God. This season of Jesus' birth, there will be much talk about love. It is good to give gifts to those who are closest to us, but let us not forget what Jesus showed as an example of loving others. It is in giving to those who are most needy, both in body and in spirit. Let us pray. Loving God, our Father in heaven, we praise you, Lord, for the message today that is so timely as we enter a season that we have learned to consider as a time for loving. Thank you, O God, for teaching and perhaps reminding us that loving others may not be easy. It is not in loving those who are lovable, but even those who may be unlovable, those who we don't even know intimately, those who are strangers, but people whom you have caused to find their way into our consciousness, into our daily activities. Lord, you will not demand of us something that is beyond our capacity. We cannot love everyone, but we can love someone, that person whom you may bring to our mind, bring to our attention one of these days. Thank you, Father, that you have given us the greatest example of what it is to love, even the unlovable. Thank you for giving us the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came so that we may have life. We give our life to you, O Lord God, and thank you that we can begin by loving those whom you are going to give our way, sometime, somewhere. We trust you, O God, to change our hearts and soften our spirits because we love you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Goodbye, everyone, for now, and I hope to see you again in our next prayer watch. God bless you.